Hey everybody, it's Matt the Dice Chucker from the Literary Gamers coming to you with another book review. This week we're taking a look at The First Confessor, The Legend of Magda Saris, sorry, that sounded like something else. This is technically, the numbers of Sword of Truth don't make sense anymore to me. This is technically number negative one of the Sword of Truth, because when you have Dead of Bones, which was your prequel of Zed, that's technically Sword of Truth zero. But in publication order, this is also book 17, because Dead of Bones adds in there. But this is part of the Richard and Kalen series. Now, I told you all, I'm getting a terrible glare, I'm really sorry. I told you all that I was going to review these in publication order. Let me talk a little bit about the publication of this series. First off, it was published as an ebook with a very limited print run in 2012. I'm going to check that date here, but I believe that is what I had seen. Yes, in 2012. However, the first edition in print by Tor was 2015. So this was an ebook long before it became part of the publication, of the print publication. And I think that has a lot to do with this connection to the Richard and Kalen series. So this is part of that arc. We're going to see some characters that we might know from previous mentions. We're going to hear about Emperor Sulachan and how they're trying to protect the people, because Sulachan is a dreamwalker, just like Emperor Jagang, or Yagang, or however you wish to pronounce it, how he was as the antagonist in the latter half of the Sword of Truth series. And by that, I mean the majority of it, because you have Dark and Raw, and then you have all your sub-villains and all that stuff. Anyway, I'm getting off topic already. So the First Confessor opens up with Magda Saris. She was the wife of, I think, the Wizard of the First Order, and now he has committed suicide, supposedly, and they're basically telling her that, you know, she has nothing left to offer this world. She meets up eventually through some expository things with Wizard Merritt, who we've also heard as the wizard who accompanied Magda Saris as First Confessor. Wizard Merritt has created this sword. He doesn't know what to call it yet, but the word truth is on the sword. So Magda Saris calls it the Sword of Truth. All the while, Lothane is pulling the strings from behind the scenes to make sure that he's got as much power as he can. And if we've been reading through most of the Sword of Truth series, we know that Lothane is a bad guy. And that there's really nothing new with that. And then you hear a lot about the power of Ordin in this book and a lot of its origins. And then you meet Alric Rall. Alric Rall has found a way to keep the Dreamwalker out of people's minds with the Bond. You'll remember the Bond is the chant, Lord Rall guide us and all that, that people were saying to keep Jagang out of their minds. This goes all the way back to what's going on with Sulachan and why we have such a chance. So the world building with that magic is shown here. And then they eventually find out that they're going to have to create a person that can find the truth and everything. So they use the Sword of Truth to create the Confessor. And this comes with a price. In order to become the First Confessor, Magda Saris has to die. And then when she does finally come back and is the First Confessor, then we get a very tense, dramatic scene of her using her new power. So that's pretty much the book. I kept it fairly spoiler-free. As a side note, if you watched the video from last week, I'm really sorry I didn't put a timestamp in the video. I am re-uploading the video right now. That has a timestamp on it. I'm going to keep the spoilers very low here. Now, I think it was around 4 years ago, on my original channel, Alpha of the Eagle, I reviewed The First Confessor. I reviewed all of the Sword of Truth books at the time. At that point, I had given First Confessor actually 4 stars. And let me explain myself here. I read this one out of order. I was very late to the Sword of Truth series, so this was the first time I had actually, in the middle of reading the series, been at a bookstore when one of them came out. It was a great deal at the time, and so I took it, and I had just finished Phantom. And so I read First Confessor, kind of as a side, Give myself a break from the Sword of Truth series as far as that linear story was going. And I enjoyed it then because even though I knew some of these people's names, I didn't really know a lot about their backgrounds and about stories about who they are. So at that point, I found the book to be quite enjoyable. Now, what are some of the cons that I have? And there's really only two main cons I have of this book. The first, we have yet another elongated chase scene. As a reader, I'm reading to enjoy these books. I'm not analyzing them. I'm not taking notes. I know plenty of people who take notes when they read books. I'm not one of them. I know that there have been some people who like to draw in their own minds. They start drawing what they see through the description, and it's great. I'm not one of those people. We were getting so many cardinal directions and standard directions from Goodkind in this chase scene that I could have, if I wanted to, sit down with a piece of paper, and as I'm reading it, go left, okay, now north, and then right, and east, and southeast. So that does nothing for me as a reader. I'm not sure if the same is for everyone else. I get no benefit out of you telling me the directions constantly. Every once in a while, it's nice. Keep it simple, left and right, ahead, behind. Don't start giving me north and south, because without a map, I don't know what north or south is, especially when it's down a bunch of corridors. So, once again, and now that I know that this was written during the time of the Richard and Kalen series, it makes sense that he's doing these very elongated chase scenes, and it's so much. And he's split the chapters up for great cliffhangers, but then there's just more. He turns, there's more. There's no way to break it up easily. Because he's so focused on his protagonist that it's very difficult to kind of get through a lot of these chase scenes. My other con is Goodkind has spent years and years, and, you know, so many previous books building this world. I'm not sure if the world of the Sword of Truth has a name, but you've got like Westeros and Middle Earth and Hogwarts and all that stuff, right? I'm not sure if the Sword of Truth world has a name. But he spent all that time building it up and building it up. And now here we are in First Confessor. You've brought us back in time. So I'd love to see what's going on in this world. I want to see the First Confessor doing what she needs to do. And the focus is all in Idendril. And that's mainly where we are. We start out at the Wizard's Keep and we never really leave the city. I'm not a fan of that. I want to see my characters moving around. I want to see my characters explore. Because when my characters explore, I learn. When I was writing much of the Call of the Architects series, I always found ways to go other places. It was very rare that there were two chapters next to each other that were within the same scene. Because to me, when you write a chapter, you write a scene. You know, think of it more like a screenwriting idea. Your next chapter is somewhere else. Well, in these 200-page chase scenes and this whole book, we're never somewhere else. We might be in a different building here and there, but we're never somewhere else. We're always in Idendril. I tried very hard not to do that. And when I was writing, I wanted the next chapter to be in the next place, at least. It might have some of the same characters, sure, but at least the previous scene leads us to the next scene. In these chase scenes, the previous scene leads us to the same location in the previous scene. So if you understand what I'm saying there, then that is a con for me. And the same thing with that, we never leave the city. It got dull. And yet I enjoyed the story of this book. I'm not sure if I would give it 4 stars again. It might drop to 3 or maybe even 2.5. Because looking back on it now, reviewing all these books, I can tell that really, what's in this is a lot of stuff that we kind of already knew. Way back when, after I finished writing the first series in the Call of the Architect, which was Rise of the Black Phoenix, I toyed with the idea of writing a prequel and intertwining it with the rest of the story. And so I started writing, and I got maybe 15,000 to 20,000 words in, and I stopped and went, I'm not telling my readers anything they didn't already know. That is huge when it comes to the art of the prequel. A lot of the details that are in the First Confessor there's the spot without the glare. But a lot of the, oh no, I lied. A lot of the details here in First Confessor tell us things that we don't really know. For example, how confessors were created at first, how the power of Ordin works, and then you get the mentions at the end about the Book of Counted Shadows and how someone's going to write it, and there might not be correct information in there in order to make sure that the power of Ordin never really gets out, and that it stays sealed. You get more about Dreamwalkers and the bond with Ulrich Rall. And that's all like the tiny minutiae I like. We know that Lothain is a villain. We know that Magnus Aris will eventually meet up with Wizard Merit to become the First Confessor and Wizard Bond. Sulachan is mentioned a lot in this book. He's never really seen. So there's that as well. And that's our connection to the Richard and Kaelin series. And I still can appreciate a lot of the things going on in this prequel. I think Dead of Bones is a better prequel because so much of it we didn't really know. By the time I read Dead of Bones, I had just finished up Faith of the Fallen. So I'm not sure if I remember Zed ever saying if he's the one who created the boundaries. But I did enjoy that little novella. With First Confessor, rethinking about it now, there are a lot of things that were mentioned. The hardest thing a prequel can do is recycle information. And I still think that there's value to this book. I know that a lot of people kind of write it off as just good kind trying to make more money. I think it was definitely an attempt to tie in events to the Richard and Kaelin series that were happening back during the time of Magnus Aris. My disappointment is that I wish that we got maybe more to this. So, for example, I want to see Magnus Aris and Wizard Merit heading out into the world and trying to solve problems. I want to see some of the hurdles that the First Confessor had and that the First Confessor Wizard Bond had with each other. I want to see how the magic grows. You know, one of the things that people have told me that Call of the Architect excels at is the world building, the history behind it all. And I wanted more of that with this. I really thought that there'd be another book after. Perhaps there is, and it just hasn't been announced yet. Maybe they found some files with Mr. Goodkind's things after his passing, and maybe he was writing a sequel to The First Confessor that would have detailed more of this. I don't know. But I do know that as far as the art of the prequel goes, it's actually not terrible. It keeps the character of the Sword of Truth series intact, and it also gives us information we didn't know. The most famous set of prequels out there being the Star Wars prequels, the big issue people had with them at the time was that they didn't feel like Star Wars, and especially in The Phantom Menace. We got more of a Star Wars feel in Attack of the Clones, but still there was something missing. So at least with First Confessor, it still felt like the Sword of Truth world, and I can give it a lot of credit for that. So this is going to be a bit of a shorter video, even though the book is longer, because there's not much to say about this book. A good chunk of it is running down hallways, and I can appreciate what's going on here. I think, though, that this is going to fall to about a 2.5 out of 5 stars for me, because looking back on it now, I can see that there really wasn't much new being put into this work. However, this does, I will be talking about The First Confessor again when I get to Warheart. Next week is Warheart. The following weeks will be 4 more weeks, and we'll have the Nikki Sister of Darkness stories. And then the final week will be Children of Dahara. That final week, so we got 5 more weeks of these Sword of Truth reviews coming out. But that final week of when we upload Children of Dahara, when I upload Children of Dahara, is going to have, I'm going to rank the books. I'm going to rank all of them. I will rank Children of Dahara as one book, though. It's not going to be because I have them in the 5 tiny little novellas in the last big one. I know they printed the large version of it, but I will be reviewing them that way. So that's it for this week, First Confessor. Have you read it? What did you think? And if you haven't already considered subscribing to the channel, we're still trying to get to at least 750, then make sure you turn notifications on. Also, this week, I'm hoping Thursday I'll be able to put up a mash bill, and we'll get some more game content coming. Jen and I just were able to just get Star Wars Villainous, so we'd love to cover that, maybe do a live play. Join us, but the only way to join us is to subscribe and make sure you got those notifications on. We'll see you next time, everybody. Bye.